a hard place, they'd want to return back to Egypt, or the thought of Egypt would come in their mind. And I was beginning to wonder, you know, that why would they want to go back to Egypt? They had left bondage, and they had walked into liberty. And what would come in their mind wanting to go back to what they where they once were? Why would they want to go back to making bricks? Why would they want to go back to the beatings? Why would they want to walk back into that place? And I don't know what would possess someone's mind to want to walk out of liberty and go back into bondage. But it crossed their minds. They wanted the melons. They wanted the things of Egypt. When things got hard. But I don't understand that. And I, you know, we don't really understand the mindset that they had at that time. But we want to look in the scriptures tonight, into the book of Isaiah, chapter 43. Isaiah chapter 43, and we'll begin reading at verse 16. Thus saith the Lord, which maketh a way in the sea, and a path in the mighty waters, which bringeth forth the chariot and horse, the army and the power. They shall lie down together, they shall not rise. They are extinct, they are quenched as tow. Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Our thought tonight would be, he'll make a way. He'll make a way. We're living in a time when that we need to increase our faith. Before we get into the meat of the message tonight, we want to look at some scriptures and see what they say about faith. In the book of Luke 17, 5 through 6, the scripture reads, and the apostles said unto the Lord, increase our faith. And the Lord said, if you had faith as a grain of mustard seed, you might say unto this sycamine tree, be thou plucked up by the root, and be thou planted in the sea, and it shall obey you. Hebrews 11 and 1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 10 and 17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So let's look at some verses tonight to help increase our faith. The psalmist wrote this, and call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. There's a story of a survivor of a wreck. He's on an inhabited island. And after a while, he managed to build himself a hut, in which he placed the little that he had saved from the wreck. He prayed to God for deliverance. anxiously every day would look out across the horizon to see if he could see a ship go by. One day when he was returning back to his hut from a hunt for food, he was horrified to find his hut in flames. Everything that he had gone up in smoke. To him it seemed the worst had happened. But that which seemed to have happened to be the worst was in reality for the best. The next day a ship arrived. "We saw your smoke signal," the captain said. "If our lives are in the hands of God," the writer, the Apostle Paul, said that all things work together for good. To them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. The psalmist also wrote, "He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him." He went on to write in Psalms 138 and 7, "Though I walk in the midst of trouble, thou wilt revive me. Thou shalt stretch forth thine hand against the wrath of mine enemies, and thy right hand shall save me." History writes that a man by the name of Wallace Johnson said, "When I was 40 years old, I worked in a sawmill. One morning the boss told me, 'You're fired.' Depressed and discouraged, he said, 'I felt like the world had caved in on me.' And this was during the Great Depression. He said, 'My wife and I, we needed the very small wages that we could get every week.' So he goes home and tells his wife, and she says, 'What are you going to do now?' He first said, 'Well, I'm going to mortgage the little home we have, and I'm going into the building business.' He says, 'My first venture is the construction of two small buildings.' Within 5 years, he records that he was a multimillionaire. Wallace Johnson was the builder of numerous Holiday Inn motels and convalescent hospitals. He says, 'Today, if I could locate the man that fired me, I would sincerely thank him for what he did. At the time it happened, I didn't understand why it happened. I didn't understand why I was fired. Later, I saw that it was in God's plan to get me into the way of his choosing.'" 1 John 3 and 13 says, "Marvel not, brethren, if the world hates you." Don't be marveled. The Apostle Paul wrote to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 10 and 13, it says, "There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it." Alexander was a little boy. He was trying to save all the money he could to get a baseball bat. But he had a hard struggle. One night when he was saying his prayers, his mother heard him, said, "Oh Lord, please help me save my money for a baseball bat. And God, don't let the ice cream truck come by down my street, because the boy would be tempted." Temptation often comes not as at our strongest, but at our weakest moment. The enemy desires to destroy what faith you have. He wants to destroy everything that he can get. As we read earlier, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. that word that comes forth from the preacher, from the Word of God, is seed that is to be planted in our lives. But the enemy desires, as we saw in the parables that Jesus began to speak about the sower that went forth to sow seed. Some fell by the wayside, some fell on good ground, some fell among thorns and thistles. The enemy desires to choke every word that comes forth from God's word out of us. Why? Because if he can destroy your faith in God, if he can destroy what faith you have in God, that belief that you have in God, he is on his way to destroying you as a child of God. He wants to destroy the faith we have. But when we are at the limit of our patience and our love, we're tempted to be unchristian. Beware of this. When did the temptation of Christ begin? After 40 days of fasting. When his natural body was weak. That's when the tempter came. And what did he show him first? He said, if thou be God, take these stones and make them to bread. He knew the Lord was hungry. He knew he was hungry, and he was hungering after something natural because of his fasting. He knew when to attack. Just as it shows us when we are at our weakest, that's when the enemy wants to come in and destroy what you have in God. People usually are more impressed when they see us act under pressure. One weak act can spoil a lifetime of witnesses that we have. The Psalmist 34:6 goes on to write, this poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all of his troubles. When you put your trust in prayer to God, he will make a way for you in the time of need. Prayer in 1620 safely guided the Mayflower with the pilgrims to a new world. Prayer in 1623 saved the Pilgrim Fathers from starvation. Prayer in 1777 at Valley Forge saved the Continental Army and won the war for American independence. Prayer at Philadelphia saved the Constitutional Convention and gave birth to the American way of life. Prayer in 1857 saved America from economic destruction. Prayer in 1918 ended World War I, and the lack of prayer started World War II. Prayer saved England at Dunkirk. Myriads of flyers and servicemen of all nations lost at sea were saved through prayer. Isaiah 43:21-22 said, this people have I formed for myself. They shall show forth my praise. But thou hast not called upon me, O Jacob, but thou hast been weary of me, O Israel. As you study the history of Israel, you'll find that God always made a way for them. He made a way to get them out of Egypt. Look at the prophecy that God spoke in Exodus 3:8. Am I come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians? And to bring them up out of the land unto a good land, and a large unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. It was prophesied that they would go into the land that those spies went into and spied out. They just couldn't them in their mind that this was where the place that God prophesied that He would bring them to. He would bring them out of Egypt. He would be with them through the wilderness, and He would take them into a land that was promised unto them years before they stepped foot into the land. God has made promises to you and I, and He'll keep the very promises that He makes to His children. We find that after they had left the land of Egypt, the heart of Pharaoh began to change. His heart was turned against Israel and began to question, why did we do this? Why did we let them go from serving us? They were the ones making the bricks. They were the ones building the cities that we could possess in our great kingdom. They were the ones here doing the work for us. Why did we let them go? We find he gathered his chariots, and he gathered, I believe, 600 to come after the children of Israel. The Egyptians, the scripture says, pursued them. And when he began to get nigh and close to Israel, they began to look behind them and see who was pursuing them. And their hearts began to get sore afraid of what was going on behind them, that they failed to look to see what was ahead of them. What was the first thing that they did? They began to murmur and complain. Because there was no graves in Egypt, why have you taken us out here to die? Why did you bring us out here into the wilderness? Didn't we tell you in Egypt to leave us alone? Don't come and talk to us about leaving Egypt. Leave us alone. We want to serve the Egyptians. They began to say it would be better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. Here they are, just a few days removed from walking out of Egypt free, and them wanting to go back into bondage again. Why, Moses, did you bring us out here? But Moses stood there and looked at them and said, fear ye not. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which He's going to show you today. For those Egyptians that you've looked behind and seen today, you're not going to see them anymore. That's the last look that you're going to get. You're not going to see them from this day forward. The Lord's going to fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. This battle belongs to the Lord. I'm going to show you the power and the mighty working power that I have. Even when we saw it declared by Jesus Christ, and He said, all power is given to me, both in heaven and in earth. I'm going to show you the power of God. The Lord looked to Moses and said, Moses, why are you crying to me? You speak to Israel and you tell them to go forward. We're not going backwards to Egypt. We're going forward to the land that I promised. I want you to understand, look at what history tells us, is that there was nearly over 6 million individuals that left Egypt. Over 4 million were Israelites, and over 2 million were the mixed multitude. million people in the wilderness heading for Canaan. 6 million. He said, Moses, lift up thy rod. Stretch it out over the sea and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. Dry ground. Not mud. Dry. I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians. They're going to follow you. And I'm going to get my honor up on Pharaoh. The Egyptians shall know that I am God and I am the Lord when I have gotten my honor up on Pharaoh. 6 million. Can you imagine the bottom of the Red Sea was actually made dry? At the place where Israel crossed, it was about 12 miles wide and about 75 to 100 feet deep. The angel of God which went before the camp of Israel now went behind them and divided them from the Egyptians, so that the Israelites walked in light and the Egyptians were in darkness. He stretched out his hand over the sea, 12 miles wide, 75 to 100 feet deep. And the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. Other passages said it was congealed, kind of like jello. But God made that ground dry where they walked. On each side, where they began to pass through, walls 75 to 100 feet high on either side of them. Now you've got to put 6 million people through the opening that God had just made. 6 million people has got to pass through the Red Sea. We're talking about the power of God. That's what we want to get into our minds tonight. This is what we can gain faith from in the God that we serve, that He's able to do abundantly above that which we ask or think. Our human minds cannot grasp that 6 million people walked through on dry ground in the midst of the Red Sea. But our God, who made heaven and earth, who made the seas and spoke them into existence, He can do such things. We have to have our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. He looked at Abraham and Sarah and he said, is anything too hard for God? We're talking about the Creator who spoke everything into existence but created man. He didn't say, let there be man, but He formed man in the likeness and in the image of God. But a God that can speak and speak things into existence, don't you think that He cares about you and I tonight? He cares about us. We are His creation. We are made in the image of God. We are His workmanship. The children of Israel went into the midst of the sea on dry ground. And the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on their left. God hardened the hearts, the heart of Pharaoh again. They pursued. Went in after them, right into the midst of the sea. But God began to look down. God's final act on the Egyptians. The scripture says that He began to trouble the host of the Egyptians. He took off their chariot wheels. He loosened the bolts right on their wheels, or however their wheels stayed on. Those wheels came off. They began to drive heavily. And they began to confess while they were there. Let us flee from the face of Israel. For the Lord fighteth for them against the Egyptians. We're in trouble. We're trapped. The Lord said, Moses, after the last one of the 6 million had crossed over, Moses, stretch out thine arm. The sea returned to his strength. When the morning appeared, the Egyptians fled against it. The Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. We find that there was not one of them that remained. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. And you know what happened? They began to believe again. They began to believe in Moses. And they began to believe in God. But it wasn't long. Moses, we need something to drink. Moses, we need something to eat. Moses, we're tired of eating manna. We want some meat. Time and time again, God performed a miracle and wrought a great work. But that thought of Egypt was so deeply embedded in them that they could not loose the hold that Egypt had upon them. It took their murmurings and complainings to a point so much that God said, "That's it. I'm going to let them wander around in the wilderness for 40 years until they die out, save Joshua and Caleb." Why? Because the scripture says that they had a different spirit about them. They had a different outlook. They understood that God had brought them out so that He could bring them into Canaan. Amen. That evil report, which is one letter short of the devil, exactly what the enemy wants to do to you and I. He wants to give you the evil report and say all things are bad. But the scripture says that greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. Just as God made a way for them, He will and can make a way for you and I. We serve a God who has all power in heaven and in earth. God is unchangeable. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Hebrew church, said, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. What He did in yesteryears, He still can do today. Just as God made a way for Israel, God can make a way no matter what the need is in every generation that will look toward Him. But I want to say a few things about faith. Ignorance brings forth darkness and death. Enlightenment brings light and direction. Ignorance is not bliss. Ignorance is bondage. You cannot have faith for that which you do not know. You cannot exercise faith for that you do not know. You cannot believe without some information. You can hope, but you cannot exercise faith. Faith is information. Jesus doesn't expect you to believe something that He hasn't told or revealed unto you. Once it comes to you from the Word of God, faith mixes and grabs it. Now you have a foundation to exercise faith. We're going to look at one more example before we close tonight. In the book of 2 Kings, chapter 4 and verse 1. Now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elisha, saying, Thy servant, my husband, is dead. And thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord. And the creditor is come to take unto him my two sons, to be bondsmen. She says, the creditor is coming for my two sons, her offspring. What's happening tonight? The enemy is knocking on the door of the church and seeking the offspring. He's seeking the next generation. Elisha began to talk with her. What shall I do for thee? In verse 2, tell me, what hast thou in the house? And she said, thy handmaid hath not anything in the house, save a pot of oil. The oil wasn't the problem. The preacher asked her, what do you have in your house? That's the first step. What do you have in your house tonight? What do you have in your house that God can use for a miracle? Or what do you have in your house that can hinder a miracle? The preacher was giving direction to this woman. Don't resist the preacher. Many people don't want preachers telling them anything. Jesus Christ was a preacher. Preachers have to give an account. You have to submit to a preacher. We need every word that we can hear. Faith cometh by preaching. Faith comes to you by the Word of God. Faith doesn't come from a concert or gospel singing. It comes by the Word of God. King Saul had a musician and a preacher. He chose the musician and left the preacher alone, and it got him in trouble. woman responds to the man of God and says, all I have is a pot of oil. The preacher says, that's enough. Tonight, some of us, we've gone through a lot. Many people here has gone through a lot. Many may be down to empty. Many may be totally drained. Some of us have less than a pot of oil. All God is looking for is a vessel. God has the oil and God has the power. God just needs a vessel to put the oil in tonight. God is saying to us tonight, if you give me the vessel, I'll give you the oil. In verse 3, what does he tell her to do? He says, go, borrow the vessels abroad of all thy neighbors. Any even empty vessels, borrow not a few. Get as many as you can. Gather them up. Bring them into the house. Do you need God to do something for you tonight? If you do, go get something that God can pour something into. Did you know that she determined the magnitude of the miracle that was going to happen? It depended on how many vessels she could get. He says, and when thou art come in, thou shalt shut the door upon thee and upon thy sons, and shalt pour out unto the vessels, and thou shalt set aside that which is full. What did he do? He says, you get everybody else out of the house, save you and your sons. This was getting personal for her and her sons. So she went from him and shut the door upon her and upon her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured out. And it came to pass when the vessels were full, that she said unto her son, bring me yet a vessel. And he said to her, there is not a vessel more, and the oil stayed. Can you imagine? That woman's got that pot of oil. And in our mind, let's just say it was 32 ounces. And she began to pour in those vessels. She comes to a vessel, it's bigger than her pot of oil. 32 in, and it keeps going. Another large vessel. Where's the bottom of the pot of oil? It was bottomless until the last vessel in the house was filled, and there was not another vessel to be filled. We're talking about a God who can take a pot of oil and multiply it. Amen. The God who made the oil. Yes. Thank you, Lord. I don't know. Could you imagine it happening to you? Lord, I've got a need. I've got creditors at my door. They're going to come take my children. They're going to work my children to pay the debt. I'll not see my children till the debt is paid. My husband was a man of God. And the man of God said, use what you got in your house. That's what he's asking of us tonight. Use what you have in your house. You got a need? Use what you have in your house. You close the doors of your house upon the things that might hinder you from getting what you need from God. You had to come to a time of separation to separate yourself from belief and unbelief. You got to shut the people out that don't believe and keep those that believe in the house. Do you think if there is unbelievers in the house that oil will continue to pour? I don't believe so. God, and listen, when Jesus Christ was doing some miracles, what did he do? He put the unbelievers out because he needed to do a work, and unbelief will hinder the works of God. Can you imagine that woman? She got really pumped up and inspired. Our senses, our seeing, our hearing, our tasting, our smelling, those are not useful in the spiritual realm. Because our eyes can tell us that will never work. But when we have faith in God, we get beyond our senses. God can work. We can't use our senses to communicate with God, to communicate with the Spirit. It's like telling your nose to hear or your eyes to taste. It just doesn't work. Why? Because God is a spirit. Do you know why God has so much trouble with humans? You see, humans are the only ones not made by the creative word of God. Everything else was a result of let there be, and it happened. They automatically obey because of their nature of creation. But God formed man. He didn't speak man into existence. He formed man from matter that was already created by his word. Breathed in him the breath of life. When we're born again, we are begotten by the word. Now you can obey God. You can obey the creator. But up to the time that you were born again, all we were was just a dead spirit. Can you imagine that woman? Is that all it takes is just a vessel? Is that all I have to have is just a vessel? What's with all these empty vessels when I just have a little small pot of oil? What good is it? But when she saw the miraculous working through obedience, things changed in her life. She began to get inspired. Let's get vessels. Let's get more vessels. Where's the next vessel? I want to keep pouring. That oil is moving. When there weren't any more vessels, the oil stopped flowing. The oil stopped when there wasn't any other place to put the oil. He said, woman, you take the oil. You sell it. You pay the debt. and you and your sons live the rest of your days on what is left. God didn't just give her enough to sustain her a while. When God does something, He does it right.
Thank you, Lord. Yeah.
He gave her enough to live the rest of her life on with her sons. Her sons were no longer going to have to go to bondage. In closing tonight, Isaiah 43 and 13, I'm going to ask the musicians to come. Isaiah 43 and 13 says, yea, before the day was, I am He. There is none that can deliver out of my hand. I will work, and who shall let it? The songwriter wrote, looking for answers, you need a way out. You've been trapped in that trial full of sorrow and of doubt. You saw a trickle of sunlight, but you found no way to escape. Just hold on to His promises. He said He'd make a way. He'll make a way in the middle of nowhere. When it seems no one really cares, He's there right by your side. He'll make a way when you feel Satan close in. Don't give up. Don't give in. He'll make a way right on time. The writer began to record about the Red Sea. Standing at the Red Sea, no place to go. Pharaoh's army was closing in. They'd soon overthrow. But right out of nowhere came a mighty strong hand. He rolled back the water and He made a way out again. He'll make a way. He'll make a way. It doesn't matter what the situation is. We've got to believe God. He'll make a way. How many times has God worked in our lives before? How many times have we seen miracles in our own lives before? David, when he destroyed Goliath, he cut that head off and took the sword. There were times when he was discouraged and not knowing what to do. He would go look at the head of Goliath and look at the sword. Those things that have occurred to us and happened to us in the past are a thing that we can draw upon and increase our faith in God. If He can do it then, He can do it now. He doesn't change. It's us that change.
It's us that sometimes move away and get weak in faith in God. But listen, we can look to the Word of God. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Let us stand.